My name's Tiffany Miller, and I work over at DMA with Brad Kimberly.
Yeah,
I'm the team lead for the social media team there, and we are responsible for managing the Department of Defense Facebook page, Twitter page, and Instagram page, along with a few other things. But I wanted to speak to you today about content curation and creation, especially right now in the current environment where we're facing hiring freezes and we're understaffed. It's really important to utilize what is already out there and curate it for our platforms and to make the most out of the content that we're creating. So at DMA, we have the social media team, but we also have these really talented folks that we work with. We have graphic artists, we have photographers, we have writers, we have storytellers, broadcasters, videographers, all sorts of folks that help us produce the stories that we want to put out on our platforms and the stories we want to tell. And we're tasked with telling that purple story. So you all may be tasked with telling a specific story at your base, or the Army's story, or a military health story, or something more specific. But we are working towards taking everything that you have and putting it out on the DoD platforms. So I'll dive into that a little bit now. So when you get started on content curation and creation, the first thing you need to do is decide, what is your audience? Who are you creating this content for? You know, you don't want to just be putting stuff out there to put it out there. You really want to cater to that audience. So how do you figure that out? Well, lucky for us, Facebook and Twitter does a really good job of already figuring that out for you. By looking at the analytic tools and the insights that they provide, you can really determine who your age is. You know, what the race, gender, salary, education, all of those things are. You know, is your audience 18-year-olds to 35-year-old males who are in the military? Are they maybe military spouses that are looking for more information on childcare or family programs that are going on in the community? What does your audience want to see? So that gets into, don't just post to post. You know, people's first priority is what matters to them and not your message. And this is really difficult for us because a lot of times we have superiors that are telling us, hey, there's this message, it just came down, we have to get it out right now. There's a memo, let's put this memo out on Facebook. And it's like, not really the best thing to go out on social media. Let's think about this for a minute and try to come up with the best plan of action. An example of this for us is the COCOMs. We work to support the COCOMs on a regular basis. And right now, the COCOMs are on the Hill. They've been on the Hill a lot last week. They're on the Hill this week. The commander of UCOM was on the Hill last week. He's on the Hill right now. Right now. So what we did, rather than just pushing it in our audience's face, watch the commander of UCOM on the Hill. We captured audio and video from his hearing, and we mixed it with images of service members in the field working towards the mission that he was talking about at his hearing, and we merged it together, and we used it as a promotion at 9:30 this morning in advance of his hearing to help promote that hearing, to push that out to our audience and say, hey, look, this is what's going on, and this is why it's important. So rather than just pushing it in our audience's face without really thinking about it, because that's what's being told we're supposed to be doing, we thought about it a little bit more, you know, take a deep breath, think about it, and came up with a better game plan. And you'll see an example of this as we go through with some videos. So what does your audience want to see when you're posting? Well, it's been proven that they want to see these five things. They want to see something that teaches them something, gives them something to talk about, looks out for their interests, has an element or surprise or humor, or inspires them. So if you could hit one of these points in one of your tweets or posts or Instagram posts or whatever other platform you're using, you're doing really well. If you can hit more than one, that's great. And if there's any way to hit all five, you're doing like fantastic. So when it comes to content curation, we have all of these resources at our fingertips that we often don't really think about. So it's our job to take inventory of what there is. And one of the most valuable assets we have is Divids. You know, a lot of times there might be an exercise going on like Flintlock, and we can't necessarily send someone there to cover it, but we can go onto Divids and find B-roll, photos, stories. We can find all of this content and create our own products from it. You know, we can create social media videos without actually having to go and capture the footage ourselves. We can take the written word in these news articles that are out there and create a blog article to inform our audience of what Flintlock is. We could put a photo essay out on Facebook to say, hey, these are our service members. They're out here doing this exercise. This is what they're doing. So it's really important to utilize Divids. And there's also pre-produced packages on there. You don't necessarily have to do the work. We're all creating this content and we're uploading it to Divids. And people want you to see their stuff. So take their content, push it out on their platforms, and help spread the word. There's also Flickr accounts. There's amazing imagery all throughout the Department of Defense. And my team, some of them are here with me today, they go through Flickr accounts daily. You know, they check out the COCOM Flickr pages, the service Flickr pages, other Flickr pages, and they find the best of the best photos to put on display on our Instagram account. Our Instagram is kind of like a display of the best of the best of what's going on, in the department. We want to highlight all of this to our audience. And then you have .gov and .mils. All of these are things that you can pull from. A lot of times for our blogs, we'll go out and see what's going on these .gov or .mil sites, and maybe we'll repurpose it. We might have it as a guest blog on DoD Live. One thing I would say about that is if you're going to repurpose a news article or a blog and put it out on your own, please give credit. It's just one of those courtesy things. Obviously, you're going to put, like, by whomever, but also maybe at the end or in the beginning, put originally posted at Navy.mil or Army.mil or wherever it may have come from, because your audience may be interested in more content that came from that site, and you can help support, you know, your fellow peers that are out there producing this content. All right, so what content do we want to share? Well, we want to share the most valuable pieces of information, and that you're going to find every day. You're going to do a search constantly, searching for the best and the best that's out there. And also another thing that's really, really valuable is to share what's out there from each other. You know, one thing that we started doing on the DoD Facebook page is at 3 a.m. every day, we are sharing something from someone else, whether it be Navy, Army, Fort Meade, whomever. We are trying to spread the word, to build up other people's platforms. And it's really, really valuable to help build that relationship with other people, but to also help bring our fan base to other people's pages. So you want to pick the best pictures or videos. You know, sometimes you might see a picture or video, but it might not be the very best. But maybe if you wait 15 more minutes, you might get a better photo or a video. And I think that's the key to social media too. A lot of times people think it's so fast paced, it's gotta go. But just be a little bit more patient. We wait for the content, wait for the best stuff to put out there. Pick the best platforms to put your content out. Maybe a video will be good on Facebook, but not so much on Twitter. You just have to play it out in your head. Think about what your audience is on this platform and maybe that platform. Maybe this video or photo will go good on Instagram, but not so much on Facebook. Use links or paths. You know, maybe you want to utilize a photo on Facebook, but there's a news article that can tell people more information about this photo, but you don't necessarily want to link it using the Facebook link path, but you can, like, put copy and paste that URL within the text when you say a little bit about what that photo is. Always link back to your platforms. Bring people back to your websites. Bring people back to your blogs. Decide how often you're going to post. Maybe you're going to post once a day. Maybe you're going to post three times a day. But stay consistent. And learn from your experiences. You know, it's okay to make mistakes. It's okay to take risks and try something. But if it doesn't work, don't do it again. You know, you never find out what's really going to work for you if you don't try. So we'll get into some content that we've created and other folks have created and show you a few examples of that now. The first example came, it's an example of a longer piece that was cut down into a teaser. So sometimes we create these longer videos. They may be 5 minutes, 8 minutes, 10 minutes long, whatever the case may be. But that's not necessarily going to do well on a social media platform. People don't have time to watch that. But maybe somebody wants to watch that video when they get home from work or when they have some more downtime. But you can put a teaser out, a short 30-second clip of what that video is about, and then link people to the longer video that they can watch later.
The Earth start to curve, and it kind of makes you feel small. We do utterly amazing things out there that we can't then go home and talk to our families about.
And that was a short clip from Airman Magazine. And Tom, correct me if I'm wrong, but I believe this was picked up by CBS. They saw it? Yeah, CBS. They saw the quick blurb, and CBS picked it up and then ran the longer one. The next clip is a short clip that soldiers put together. And it just goes to show, sometimes people think that it's all about, you know, chasing that big story. Finding that big news story or, you know, feature story and going and traveling to wherever to cover it. But sometimes it's the simple videos that do the best on social media. You know, a lot of times Brad and I are trying to tell our team, create a video of sailors coming home and off a ship and reuniting with their families. You know, show a video of an exercise, of explosions. That's what people want to see. It doesn't necessarily have to be like the latest and greatest invention coming out and every single thing to know about it. The next video is actually when the Army changed their sleeve rolling initiative or regulations for their sleeves. And folks at DMA, they just went back to the back conference table and shot a quick video on how to roll your sleeves. And it did so well that it actually reached more people than the soldiers' Facebook page had fans. So it was definitely a viral video. Also kind of a way to like think outside of the box. You know, someone may have said, get that message out right away, put a memo out, create a blog, but people don't necessarily want to just read about that. Like, that's so much more interesting than just reading a blurb saying, hey, you know, we changed the way you're going to roll your sleeves. Now you can watch this video, and it was picked up and it was shared and people loved it.
Music sells it.
The next video is actually something new that we created at DMA. We've been doing it for a little while now, but it's UConn by the Numbers, and it's a DNN, and it kind of gives people an inside view on what UConn is. You know, we have these COCOMs, but people don't necessarily know what COCOMs are or what they do, and we have these abbreviations. So we kind of spelled it out for them. And we have this text. There's no voicing. It's just text and imagery.
Thank you.
Now, this video is out of date right now. We have to update it. But it's one of those things that's kind of, we can always go back in and change it. And we actually created it in advance of Secretary Carter's trip to UConn to kind of educate our audience on why he was going there, why it was important, what this was for. And it was something that we were working towards doing for all of the COCOMs, and it's something that we're continuing to do. But it's also great to utilize text within videos. As you all have probably done in the past, you may be doing it now. You can be sitting on your phones in a setting where you can't use audio, but you might be scrolling through and you find a video that you want to watch. But if there's text on it, you can watch it. If it doesn't have text or captions, you can't watch it. So definitely use text or captions within any photo or any videos that you're posting online. It increases your reach, it increases your numbers, it increases your audience viewership. So here are some examples of infographics. Infographics are definitely things that I think we underutilize. The first infographic is something that we created, again, when Secretary Carter was traveling to the Asia-Pacific region. There was a lot that wasn't known about what was going on in that region or why he was going. So we decided, how can we educate our audience on this? And the best way of doing that was by using this graphic. And this is a graphic that we utilized, I think, at least 5 or 6 times while he was in his position. We put it out on Facebook, on Twitter. I believe he used it on his own personal page. And it was definitely a really great informative graphic, and it's something that people still talk about today. You know, the head of the graphics department was at my desk earlier this week, and he was like, hey, I think we should create a graphic for Secretary Mattis's trip. You remember that Asia Pacific region graphic? Maybe we can do something like that. So it's something that people have definitely referred back to. It's left a lasting impression. So just kind of thinking outside of the box. If you have all of these numbers and all of this information, how can you figure out ways to put it out to your audience? And you don't necessarily have to have a graphics department to create this. There are so many apps and platforms available to you now that you can do this yourself. You can go online, find, you know, just like Google, create infographic, and things will pop up. Some are free, some you have to pay for, and you can like plug the numbers in and create your own graphic. So these are graphics from Inherent Resolve. They obviously have two very different audiences that follow them, you know? So they are putting out graphics for two different languages. You know, they're hitting two big audiences here, and it's become very successful. They'll put one out, maybe an hour later they'll put another out. So maybe this is something to think about if maybe you're at a base on the border of, say, the U.S. and Mexico. Maybe you want to put a tweet out in English followed by a tweet out in Spanish. Are you hitting different audiences that need different things in different languages? It's very easy to do if you have somebody that knows the other language and can help change the text for you. It's simply the same thing, just in different text. All right, so blogs. At DMA, we have two blogs that we utilize. We have DoD Live, that you'll see this is the main page for, and over in the right corner here, Armed with Science. The blog is a great way to push out content in an informative and educational way to your audience. A lot of you may have blogs that you can put content on. I know the services have blogs. If you ever need a platform to utilize, feel free to reach out to us. We can help you draft blogs. You can send in guest blogs to us. We'd love to post these for you. But we utilize this site as a way to educate our public on things that they may not know about. You know, top 5 things you didn't know about NATO. Or as you see here, the force of the future, Admiral Harris talks rebalance and why it's an exciting time to be in the military. So we take information that we want our audience to use, and we push this out on social media and link back to this blog. So we'll take like the teaser, push that out on social, link it back here. where people can learn more. Then you have the Arm with Science. Yolanda, who's here, manages our Arm with Science blog. And it's where everything and anything science related that meets military lives. So the up and coming innovations, 3D printing, how we're saving energy, things like that are all on this blog. And it's really, really been very beneficial. We started a new, campaign, Medal of Honor Monday. Every Monday we highlight a new Medal of Honor recipient and how they received the Medal of Honor and kind of a background of their story. And it's been extremely successful. So again, if you need a place to put content, if you're interested, feel free to reach out to us. We'd love to help get you on our blog or highlight anything that you may have. So then you have your live options. You have Facebook Live, which has proven to be extremely successful and really push your numbers overboard because Facebook does the promoting for you. When you go live, Facebook is trying to pull in that audience for you. They're like, hey, DoD is going live right now, tune in. You can bring in your own feed if you're going live on defense.gov and you can stream it directly through Facebook. You can have promotions go through Facebook as well. Then you have Periscope on Twitter. It used to only live for 24 hours, but now it lives forever. And they'll talk about that more when they're here, but that's really, really a great thing now. And then you have Instagram Stories and Instagram Live, which is a new thing, kind of like them working with Snapchat. I won't get into Snapchat because we don't utilize that. Instagram Stories and going live on Instagram is something that we've done a little bit here or there, but posting direct photos or videos to our actual platform has been more beneficial for us overall. So also, jumping into trends, can you pay attention to trends and join the conversation? But does it fit with your persona? You know, National Puppy Day, I think, was last week, and we jumped in on the conversation because we have military working dogs, and obviously they're going to start as puppies and become military working dogs. So we had a great team back at DMA create this video that told the story of how these military working dogs start out. They start as little puppies, and then they become these dogs that are helping our service members overseas. And it did really, really well, and it helped to serve the trend that day. We have International Doctor, is it International or National Doctor Day? National Doctor Day coming up Friday, or Thursday. Thank you. So we can highlight it as well. I mean, we have lots of military doctors within the service. We had National Dentist Day that we highlighted, and we had a picture of a service member brushing their teeth out in the field saying, you know, thank your dentist on National Dentist Day, making sure your hygiene's good even when you're out in the field. So there's ways to, you know, jump in on those trends if it can enhance your mission and if it can relate to what you're putting out there and your cause. So here is an example of our Run a Show, and I wanted to show this to you all. This is an older version of it because it fits on the screen nice. Our Run a Show now is really long. But it's how we get organized. So managing the accounts for DoD, we have a lot of people to answer to and, you know, reach out to and talk to. So what we do is we plan out our day a day ahead. So right now, we are scheduling out for tomorrow. And we will put all of our content in a Run a Show and copy and paste each post. And once each post is copy and pasted into that document, we send it to our editors who look through it, edit it for any typos, mistakes, whatever it may be. They send it back to us. We look over it, see if we want to accept these changes, change them within our tweets, our Facebook posts, and whatnot. And then we send it off to this large distribution. And on this distribution, we have people like Tatum, who's visiting us from Hawaii, who works with Paycom. We have folks from OSD. So what they do is sometimes Tatum will say, hey, Tiffany, you know, I see you have this, but Paycom's pushing this out tomorrow. Maybe you can work it into your share. I think it'll go well with this photo. Or the folks at OSD will be like, run a show looks good, but just so you know, the sec def's going to be meeting with this MOD at this time. Maybe we can put a photo out on it. So it's a way for us to kind of communicate with the folks that we want to work with and collaborate with, but also keep ourselves in check. So if we're missing something that we're supposed to be covering, there's multiple eyes on it that can say, hey, you guys forgot this. Or, you know, Medal of Honor Day was on Saturday. If we forgot to highlight it, somebody could have said, you know, you guys forgot to mention Medal of Honor Day in your run of show. You might want to add that in. And it's a really great way for us to stay on track of things as well, because like for today, we had the UCOM commander on the Hill, and we were going to put a promo out at 9:30 and then also amplify UCOM's messaging. So we can reflect back on the run of show that morning when we get in and say, oh, this is what I have to do today. Make sure that I stay on top of everything that's on my to-do list. And you'll see we put in scheduled if it's already scheduled, or we'll have somebody's name under there if they're responsible for it that day. This has also been really helpful when the secretary's traveling. He's traveling this week, and we'll take, you know, the itinerary, and we'll pull out little things that we want to cover, and we'll plug it into the run of show of, this is our plan for this day. Make sure nothing else is going out on Facebook at that time. Make sure nothing else is going out on Twitter. So it's a great way to get organized and to plan ahead. So I know I've been talking a lot. So now it's really time for you just to reflect and figure out what your strategy will be. I know most of you already have a strategy, or you're already utilizing Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and all of that, but maybe it's time to kind of reevaluate all of that. You know, figure out what platforms you'll use, what times make the most sense for you to post. How are you going to engage with your audience? Are you going to comment back at them if they comment to you? Are you going to like what they're commenting if they're, you know, posting on your Facebook posts? What DoD entities will you follow and amplify? You know, does Army want to follow the Marines and share some of their content, or do they not? And what campaigns will you initiate and utilize? All things to keep in mind as you move forward. So that's all I have for you. Does anybody have any questions? Yeah. I think it's going to get you the mic.
Hi, my name is John Jung. I'm the digital communications for the Defense Health Agency. We're really trying to get into Facebook Live, but we don't know how it works. If you have Facebook Live, how can that be 508 compliant? Is there some way for that?
How it can be what compliant?
508 compliant.
Oh, I don't know. Do you
know? I might be able to answer that. So, sorry to cut in on your.
No, you're fine.
Green. All right. In regards to 508 compliance, that Facebook Live is, as I understand it right now, is not 508 compliant. However, when you're using the Facebook Live API that is routing a broadcast signal into Facebook Live as opposed to using your cell phone, if that signal is encoded with closed captions, if you're paying a captioner to caption your product, then it does get encoded into the signal. And then it's incumbent upon the player of the platform that you're using to have that capability of decoding it. I know that on Twitter, for instance, if you upload a video from Snappy, cut video from Snappy that has closed captions encoded into it, like hard encoded into the video, the player on mobile will show the captions, but on the desktop it doesn't. So from the social media platforms themselves, it's still a work in progress. Do the best you can. When the video is done, you should theoretically you should be able to add captions after the fact. But that's what we do.
Yeah.
for the most part.
Or sometimes we'll do a Facebook Live of an event, say like an enhanced honor court on. So it's not necessarily people speaking. It's just, you know, a parade, you know, proceeding through or something like that.
I wanted to make sure that I addressed this because we did have a question come in through email about being 508 compliant for this. We are going to share these sessions on YouTube. All of the cameras are actually recording to SD cards, and we will be uploading to YouTube with captions after the facts and making a playlist for the different sessions that we're having. So that's how we're addressing being 508 compliant after we receive that request from the field.
My name is Wayne Svoboda. I'm a professor at the City University of New York at its Graduate School for Journalism. I was interested in your mention that of all the possible uses, you don't use Snapchat. Why is that? What was your thinking?
So it's something that we definitely explored. We have a Snapchat account, and at the time we just decided it was best for us to really focus in on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram. You know, sometimes you just have to decide, are your resources better off focusing on the platforms you have rather than spreading yourself thin? You know, you don't want to say you're going to do a platform and not really make it what it should be. If you don't have the time to invest in it, you don't necessarily want to initiate it. And we didn't necessarily have someone to, you know, devote to Snapchat, and we didn't have the best plan. I mean, being DOD, it was a little bit more difficult to come up with a strategy for it, and we just weren't there, especially as we were changing administrations. But it's not something that we're definitely not going to explore in the future. We just had to put it on the table for now.
That was a nice presentation, by the way. Did you do that technically? Was that Prezi?
It is Prezi. Thank you.
I think you were going to ask that.
Prezi, yes.
All those batteries. Those darn batteries.
Okay. I'm Mike Burnett from Army Media.
One of the ways that we use the program.
This is censorship. One of the ways that we've overcome it in the past is with a person who could do sign language too. For instance, you could have someone here standing by the podium doing sign language if you have someone in your organization. I think if you pay to have closed captioning done live, it's about $150 an hour, something like that.
That's a good idea.
Last year, we did have somebody who did that because we had the request for the need in person. So we did have somebody do that last year. This year, it was not identified that there was going to be anybody attending in person for that need to be met.
Great presentation.
Thank you.
Quick question, kind of piggybacking on what he had alluded to with not using Snapchat. For the platforms that you do utilize, mm-hmm. is there, and you had mentioned sometimes, you know, changing the time you post or the frequency of posts. Was there ever a situation, or how do you decide that, you know what, maybe we need to change, and then two, when you do incorporate those changes, how long, you know, what's the duration of those changes in order for you to gauge whatever you are looking for, whether it's reach, whether it's engagement, so on and so forth.
Sure. You kind of have to just like figure it out and like play around with it a little bit. We definitely change the number of times that we've been posting on our platforms. For example, I think when I first started, you know, 2 years ago, we were just posting 3 times a day on Facebook, and Twitter was kind of just like random. You know, there was really no method to our madness. And then we got into a system, and it was, you know, constantly a set time on Twitter and a set time on Facebook. And then we jumped to, you know, 6 posts a day on Twitter and 6 posts a day on Facebook. And we realized that it was just way too much on Facebook for 6 posts a day. You know, you're just kind of overloading your audience there. And then you're putting out really great content that's getting lost. Because if you're putting out 6 great pieces of content, maybe only 1 piece of content is really resonating with your audience. So then we scaled back a little bit, and we're back to like 3 to 4 posts on Twitter and 3 original posts on Facebook and 1 share on Facebook. So I think it's just, you kind of have to play around with it, you know, roll with the tide a little bit and figure out what works for you and really look at the analytics that Facebook and Twitter gives you. Because things are going to change. Your audience is going to change. I mean, when Secretary Mattis came in, our audience changed a little bit because he had a following that we didn't have before. So you just kind of have to figure it out and adapt. I mean, social media is all about that, just adapting. Things are never the same.
Mm-hmm. So we have a question from Facebook from Sarah Yoke. And she was asking, in relation to Facebook Live, is there anything controversial that we know of that's happened in the DoD? And then I'm going to add a follow-on. What are some best practices for doing Facebook Live?
So controversial, is there any specifics on the controversy? Or?
Well, is there anything that, any precedents or anything that we should be aware of in the DoD for controversial topics? Making sure that we're staying on point for upholding the good conduct. What is your advice along those lines of controversy for live Facebook feeds?
Yeah, I think for the Facebook Lives, you would stay on message and follow the messages coming down from your leadership. I mean, you obviously want to get approval for Facebook Live. You don't want to just go rogue and just do whatever on Facebook Live. As for us, for best practices, I think, you know, just go for it. I mean, there might be an event going on and you might be a little timid about doing a Facebook Live because you've never done it before, but chances are it's going to be a hit and it's going to go over well. We have really seen that people enjoy seeing the behind the scenes view of Facebook Live. You know, people can watch live streams all day long of things going on in DC, at the Pentagon, on the Hill. And we can put those feeds in through Facebook, but what they don't see are the things that aren't getting broadcast. You know, if you, for example, when we were at Pearl Harbor, you know, I did a Facebook Live actually with my cell phone, I'm capturing it myself, of a reef laying on the USS Arizona. And it was an incredible moment to be there for the 75th anniversary to capture that and for the audience to see something that wasn't actually being filmed by any, you know, news crews, by, you know, actual video cameras. So kind of like getting the behind the scenes things that nobody else is getting, I think, for Facebook Live to really go after.
Hey, first of all, great presentation, Tiffany. For the social media managers here, I just want to ask a question. You touched on a little bit about approvals, but obviously, with social media, you have the concern of OPSEC, operation security. What advice would you give to the social media managers in terms of really ensuring that the content that goes out receives some kind of OPSEC scrub or review?
Sure. So for OPSEC, for us, we don't necessarily really run into that because we're not really on a space. We're not really telling when people are coming home or things like that. We're not really dealing with sensitive material, I wouldn't say, per se. And the Pentagon's checking off on everything that we have. So I think maybe if you have anything that is sensitive or like that, definitely maybe create a run a show like I showed you and send it through like a leadership process. You know, send it off to have people check off and say, okay, yeah, you can say this. You know, if a Navy ship's coming home and you think it might be too close within that window to say, you know, get ready, sailors are coming home type thing, just get special approval. I think it's common sense just to make sure if you in your gut are questioning anything, it probably isn't good. Yeah.
We have another question from online in Facebook land from Indiana Guardsman. How do you manage the strategic messaging goals of the organization with an engaging content strategy that is relevant and deliberate for the organization? So I'm going to translate a little bit because that was kind of long. It seems like, how do you connect the overarching strategy and being intentional to a relevant audience?
Sure. So this is something that we are working on daily. I mean, one of the things that we work with specifically is taking the SecDef's priorities and pushing them out on our social media platforms. And I think you just really have to brainstorm. You know, look at that imagery, and if you see a really awesome photo and you want to put it out on social media, how can you connect that to the messaging? How can you say, oh, well, they're out there in the field doing this exercise with our NATO allies, so we can say we're, you know, joint training out there, and, you know, tag NATO and UCOM, and there's our messaging right there. We're staying on strategy and staying on point. Or, you know, you just kind of have to, like, think outside of the box and how you can tie everything back to it and relate it to your strategy overall. And I think when it comes to, you know, the policy and the stuff that's not so fancy and enticing, think of ways to put it out there in an interesting way. So if you have a policy that on paper is really, really boring and you're just like, I don't know how people are going to understand this, maybe, you know, dumb it down for them in a sense. You know, create a blog and pick out the top five things that people need to know about this new initiative and put it out there. Or maybe create like a 30-second video with the top five things with like flashy text and images underneath and push it out on social media. That way you're getting your message out there, but you're getting it out there in an interesting way.
So the only thing I'd want to add to that is I had a boss who talked about it's almost impossible to surge friendships. The other thing for interest, those times in between whenever you're at a crisis or you need to put out information, you need to be focused on, and the Marines do this a lot, which is hijacking current events so that you have a following. So when you do have important information, you have the potential for that following to also see those things.
He has a question here. You want to bring the mic back? Pass it around.
Now, I see that you schedule out most of your posts for the day, but how do you deal with when you have, like, a crisis communication or, like, a breaking news? Come on, do you, like, withhold your information and put it when it can thrive better, or do you just let it go as scheduled?
Sure, so it all depends. We have to, you know, just gauge it. You know, heaven forbid there's an active shooter somewhere. I mean, this has happened, and it's, like, hold the presses. Like, we're pooling all of our, like, unschedule all of the stuff on Facebook that's going out, pull the tweets. It's waiting. We're going to put out the news that's going on right now, and we're going to wait for maybe a statement from OSD on how we want to proceed or whatever it may be. So we may have stuff that's scheduled, but we're always monitoring. Just because it's scheduled doesn't mean we're on autopilot and we're just kind of like sitting there, you know, eating bonbons and not paying attention. Yeah, Brad does that, though. And even on the weekend, though, so say something happens on the weekend and we have all of this scheduled content, we always have somebody on due date. So we always have somebody on call that's there, that's our point person if something were to happen, that can go in and pull stuff or edit stuff. Or like when Mattis was confirmed, and he started work on a Saturday. So Brad and I are posting videos of SecDef Mattis coming in on a Saturday and tweeting it out and all of that stuff. So we just kind of have to roll with it. And gauge what's going on. And unfortunately, you know, sometimes our messaging is a little bit delayed because we do have to wait for our OSD to tell us exactly what's going to go on, but we'll just remain silent until we get that messaging. But we don't want to put out a puppy photo if, you know, something awful is going on.
Yeah. I have another question from Abe McNatty. He asks, does every command need a public social media platform? For example, a DDG might have a Facebook, which is a destroyer for everybody who's not in the Navy. But so does its DESRON, which is its parent command, and so does its strike group. So at what point, he had a follow-on to that, at what point do we move to collaboration as opposed to competition?
I think that would be up to the command, and I think if it makes sense to combine them, then that would make the most sense. So you would obviously have to communicate that. If there's a use for separate platforms, then maybe it's most beneficial to keep them separate. If there's separate messaging going out from each platform that doesn't necessarily pertain to everyone. But if it would be more beneficial for them to all be together as one, then maybe that makes the most sense. I know when we first started, we had a DoD News Twitter handle and a Department of Defense Twitter handle. And at the time, we decided to merge them because we thought it would be the same messaging. And now looking back, we're kind of like, maybe that wasn't really the best decision because we have a lot of news that we don't necessarily want to put out on our Department of Defense Twitter handle. So maybe you merge them and then decide it's not the best thing and then separate them again. I think it just, it depends on the command and the folks involved, and they just need to have that conversation. But I couldn't really answer that myself. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Hello. Michelle, Joint Base Anacostia-Bowling Public Affairs. Wanted to get your feedback on going live to engage with the audience when they can't attend in person, but then not knowing if the situation could go negative. Example, we had a series of power outages on our base last summer, and we wanted to have a town hall to let the community know, the base community know what was going on and how we were going to rectify it. We knew it was last minute when we scheduled it and that a lot of family members and residents couldn't attend. So we wanted to go live to let them be able to ask their questions virtually and then we could address them at the town hall. But then also with it being a power outage town hall, we realized that, hey, this could go negative very fast. How do you weigh that going live when you don't know if it'll be completely positive, but you also want to reach your audience?
Well, I think in that case, if it's something that is important to your audience, such as a town hall, then I think, I mean, again, it's going to depend on you and the people that are running it. I would say put it out there because it's pertaining to your audience. Not everything's going to be positive. I mean, we have posts all the time on DoD that aren't positive, and you just have to like take the positive with the negatives. But at least you are allowing your audience to see this, and you are allowing the audience that wasn't able to attend in person an outlet for them to view it, especially if it was last minute. And you have to understand, I mean, a power outage is going to be viewed as negative regardless.
Hello. I just wanted to just make a quick comment on the last question about does every unit need a Facebook page? If you're looking at, and I hate to be the guy who points out, you know, directives and doctrine, but if you're looking at Joint Pub 3-61 Annex F specifically, right? the language is loose, right? It's basically up to the discretion of your communication efforts. Social media is powerful. It's value added. But if it's too much work, if you don't have the manpower, if you can collaborate, if you can collapse, I've seen, you know, a lot of Facebooks come together to become one bigger Facebook that has very similar messages, especially in that case where it's kind of a hierarchy of messaging. So I just want to make that comment that right now there's no requirement, there's not, but the language is loose, probably on purpose, because they're not. No one's going to say you need social media. But the value's there to have one if you can maintain it. It might hurt even more if you can't maintain it.
Any other questions? Yeah. All right. Well, thank you for having me. Thank you.